Persyn est là ce soir, un des associés du bureau, pour en parler plus. Donc je voudrais lui laisser la parole. Merci.
Bonsoir. Merci d'être venus si nombreux. C'est très généreux de votre part. Et je suis très content de faire une petite conférence à Liège, une des villes les plus fascinantes de la Belgique, je pense. C'est aussi prévu que je parle en anglais, donc c'est ça que je vais faire. From now on, I'll switch to English. So today I prepared a talk, which I hope will not be too long, in order also to leave some time to exchange after I spoke. A talk that is structured around the question of a vertical architecture, a tower, but also I wove in some other issues, some other items to talk about the city, because I think that's what, in essence, the architecture is about, to construct cities and to construct places that we would like to live in. So maybe first some background. Our office is located in Brussels. Until a few months ago, we were located in Molenbeek, a part of Brussels that is notorious by now. And recently, we moved to the World Trade Center in the center of Brussels, in the North District. And I will explain later why. But here you can already see the project that I will talk about, the tower in Tirana. So the name 51 and 40 stands for the coordinates of Brussels, and as you have seen with the two previous pictures, it's a reality which is very multiple, which is multi-layered, which has its own dynamic. And I think that's also something that I find fascinating about architecture, is that it's a tool to reveal that reality and to intervene in that reality and to understand it and give it shape. So 51 and 40, 51 north, 4 east. when we talk about Brussels, of course, we don't talk about cities like we know them or get taught about them. So this is somewhere where Brussels is. It's clear that in the 20th century, the idea of a city has become much more complex and much more difficult to apprehend. And we can say that the 20th century is maybe a century in which an accumulation of architects and architectures made a space which is very complex, very difficult to understand. And we also see it as the challenge of today to somehow work with that complexity and to basically stop working in a mode, in an methodology of just adding objects, but really to use architecture and the objects that we make to reshape the environments that a piece of architecture is a part of. And that's maybe the core thing that I want to discuss in this talk today, is how if you work with an architecture, if you work with an object, how the focus should in a way be beyond that object, and how, for us, for 51 and 40, that's where the real challenge and also the real potential of doing architecture today is. So, since we work here, why do I talk about Albania, which is a very remote place? Of course, first reason is simply because we have built a high-rise building there and not in Belgium. We would love to also build high-rise in Belgium, but until today the question has not been asked or put on the table. Partly, I think, also because high-rise, and maybe Liège is a good example of that, high-rise has become a bit suspicious. It has come to stand for real estate speculation to a large extent. And if you look at Belgium, there's something to say for that suspicion. I mean, there's something to say about, also if you look at the World Trade Center in Brussels, real estate speculation has somehow multiplied the square meters, but not necessarily multiplied the quality that these big buildings add to the city. In Albania, the situation is of course very different. Albania is a country which was a socialist regime, which was isolated, comparable to North Korea today. Only, let's say, end of 80s, the regime collapsed and the country opened up. So the country was, and in that sense, is still today very much in the dynamic of development. You could say that the spirit of the 60s, I haven't witnessed. I was born during the crisis after the golden 60s. But I think you can say that in Albania, this kind of spirit of development, of finding new opportunities, is very strong, and that's also why the tower vertical architecture is, I think, very attractive, because it says something about going high, going. The sky is the limit, let's say. this is the tower that we have built. It's in that sense, it's maybe a small skyscraper. It's only 85 meters high. So compared to international standards, this is nothing. It doesn't even qualify to enter into high-rise contests. So we try to apply for a prize of high-rise in Munich, but the building was too low to be on the list. Nevertheless, due to its shape and to its proportion, it's clearly a high-rise. It's a building of 85 meters high, which has a footprint of more or less 25 by 30, but it also is a building which has a larger base, like many towers have. And I think this base is an issue that we could also discuss today. when we talk about high-rise, we talk about the idea of development, we talk about the idea of advancing also, the idea of progress. What I would like to talk today also about is maybe beyond that idea of the tower, and also this is maybe a bit of a personal frustration. We have been busy to develop architecture in Albania since 2004. So today that's 13 years. And last year we produced a book, which is this book, which is called How Things Meet. You can look at it later. And How Things Meet we made because our presence in Tirana was ended up being much more engaged, also engaging, also much more multiple than this one high-rise building. Nevertheless, only the high-rise building got really known because it's such an important and visible object, as you can see. But to us, the work in Tirana has been much more than building this icon, and it's also about this that I would like to talk today. And I will talk to it through the lens of this book, because this book somehow summarizes a lot of the dreams and a lot of the tension that we have dealt with. And although Albania is a very foreign context and very different than Belgium, I think in an interesting way, the situation of the country is also something that we can learn from a Belgian perspective. And maybe it has to do with trust, it has to do with daring to dream and daring to reinvent yourself. This book, How Things Meet, is a co-production, so we have made it together with Stefano Graziani, who is an Italian photographer, who took photographs of the city and of our work in the city, and of Falma Shvazi, who is an Albanian writer. And the book that you see here is actually the extended version, because the simple version is this one. And this is also an Albanian version of that book. And basically the book started as an idea to, at the opening of the tower, which eventually became a hotel, to produce a book that could function a bit like a tourist guide, you could say, or as an eye-opener to the city of Tirana. And that's why we produced this book. This book is the same as this one, except for the fact that there's an equal amount of pages of project documentation added to it. So here you see the two together. This is the end of the first book, the hotel book, and this is then with the extended version, which became the architectural book, you could say. So what does this hotel book do? It somehow tries to photograph the city and its peculiarities. So the city of Tirana obviously is a very informal, very classic city, as you can see in this picture. But it's also a symbol, I say, I think this picture says something about how proactive Albanian society is, how there's a kind of urge for development and how everyone self-organizes him or herself, which is maybe a link that we could make with Belgium, where also people have a big tendency to self-organize themselves. And the idea of this picture book is somehow to look at the city and to look at it with, you could say, maybe innocent eyes, to look for the beauty that is in the city and to somehow show also to other people the beauty that we saw in that city. And in this picture, part of our work is present, and I will leave it up to you to discover it later. Another part of the book, as I said, is the text by Fama. It's a text which is following a character called Eja. Eja is an Albanian word. In Albanian, the gender of the name is difficult to decipher. Basically, in Albanian, you can write in a neutral gender, not in a male or a female, which means that you follow this Eja on a 48-hour trip throughout Tirana, which I think is a kind of short summary of the 12-year trip that we took. And then Eja, to me, maybe is a bit like a tenta, and also that's why why this book has this kind of shape. It's kind of bondi sine, you could say. In the idea of talking about architecture, talking about the quality of living in a city for an audience which is not just architectural. The second part of the book starts with this timeline, and this timeline shows all of the projects that we have done in Tirana now until a year ago. And this is also how the book is structured. So here you see the years. So it goes from 2004 until 2016. It starts with the TID Tower, our somehow big entry into the country. But it also shows all of the tests that we did, all of the exercises, all of the attempts, all of the successes, but also a lot of the failures. And then you somehow see what the timeline of these projects is in relation to the pages of the book. The production that we have done in Tirana is not finished. This book was just a moment to look back, but it has been a very diverse type of production, which goes from indeed the TID Tower to the project for a square, to refurbishment of the cabinet of the Prime Minister, to a bridge, to a monument. It all started in 2004, when the country was really still in a very rough state. So here, this is a picture of the first drive that we took from the airport to the center of the city. And this is the developer of the tower. And you can also see the kind of state the country was in back then. Almost no roads, a lot of buildings popping up all over, and very old and growing car army in the streets, which was also in big contrast to the years during socialist time, when only the apparatchiks have had cars, and the whole city was run by bicycles. So also the car, in that sense, just like the tower, is a symbol, more than a need, I think. A social scientist that I had been talking to a few years ago was, for instance, explaining how actually the washing machine is a much more important device for developing countries. But very often families were in a dilemma: would they buy a car which has more status, or would they buy a washing machine which has more practical gain and actually emancipates, you could say, the mother more. Turns out very often a car was bought without even the remains to buy the petrol to actually run it. So to come into in such a condition as a very young architect, I was 30 back then, is of course exhilarating, it's fascinating, and it's also very difficult to grasp. The project that we proposed and the competition that we won looked at this condition and tried to use the architecture to say something about that condition. So this is a picture of the central square back then. So you see the opera, which is a socialist building, you see the mosque, you see the clock tower, and this is the silhouette of where the tower would be. And we were somehow confronted with this kind of condition, which we found somehow attractive, because we came there with the idea that Albania was indeed a former East European country. But almost coming there, you witness Italian vibe, with a lot of people in the streets, with a very intense use of the public space. And we tried to couple this with this kind of desire for luxury that we also very intensely felt from the developer. And we proposed a tower which starts as a circle and ends in a square. So this was the very simple, basic idea. And why did we do that? It was to somehow respond to the impossible footprint this tower has. Already 25 by 30 meters is a very small footprint. And the idea of elegance was rendered the whole project simply impossible. And then by having the tower grow towards the top, we were able to answer the square meter question and produce an elegance with producing something that works with light and shadow, which you see here in this tiny model, how on a very basic shape you start to draw a shadow with this Mediterranean sun. And another thing that we wanted to do is to not have this building as the kind of eye-catcher, maybe contradictory, but we felt that in this kind of very beautiful composition that the city already was, it was important not to make a Dubai tower, which is very big, you could say, but to try and more make a mineral tower, a tower which would be made out of stone and not made out of glass. And then a last element, which was important, I think, for the competition, was that on the foot of this tower, which you can see here, there was this extremely tiny monument, almost very easily overlooked, which is the tomb for the founder of the city, Ottoman Suleiman Pasha. And so we proposed to create with the building a kind of quarter of a dome to embrace that the oldest monument of the city, which was actually the move that triggered a lot of reaction, also in newspapers, because this kind of attitude of not only going for the new, but also integrating the old, was something that in previous project apparently did not happen very quickly or very easily. So these were the basic outlines of our competition proposal, and then This was presented in a way as a kind of work in progress, as a laboratory. This was our office back then. And we also presented in the competition the project in such a way. And that was also very interesting. We were able to present the project in such a way because it was, you should imagine it as a televised event with an audience at least as big as this one, where you were presenting your competition proposal live. You were able to argue for it, explain why you did certain things. And so it was not a competition where you were producing panels, which were then looked at by a jury in a closed room, but it was really the beginning of a dialogue. And I think this is something very important. We were able to somehow show what we were convinced of, but also to share our doubts. And this last one, I think, especially in a country like Albania, but I think also in Belgium, is something that is actually never possible. You always have to be the best, you always have to convince. And I think we all know that architecture is just about trying out. So in that sense, I found it very worthwhile, very important also for us, that we were in a situation where we could give this nuance. One of the things that we were very convinced about was the idea of making a mineral tower. Here's a test of making it in brick, terracotta elements. This was the thing that the developer was not convinced about at all. So the day after the competition, although he accepted the choice of the jury, he told us that what we proposed was impossible. And with these words, we embarked on continuous dialogue with them, trying to come up with other solutions and trying to convince them that the ideas that we had, the intentions that we had were possible, were necessary, but could also find a shape which was very different than the shape that we invented here. As I said, this was the beginning of a lot of back and forth between Tirana and Brussels. And also accompanied with smaller projects, because somehow suddenly we found ourselves in the center of attention of a society in big need for things to happen, for newness, for we were somehow suddenly exotic, wanted, which was very nice. We didn't have that feeling in Belgium, so to say. And also a real territory for experiments. So this is a sketch that we made to paint the facade. Just with a bucket of paint, what can we do to change the impact of the building? This was part of the program that the mayor of Tirana back then, Edi Rama, was famous for. Basically accepting that he had no means and treating renovations of buildings not as just renovations but as ways to claim that there is an urgent need to look at the collective space of the city again. This is a story that you can look up on the internet. I will not go into it here. But if you look up Edi Rama, Colors of Tirana, you will find a lot about it. Another project on the side that we did was a very unlikely project, a project for a gas station. A gas station sitting on the entrance to the city of Tirana, and which was, the question was to make an iconic gas station. I think it also, it's a very dubious question, of course. And the thing that we proposed was in line with the kind of investigation that we had set out with the tower, and we wanted to make a suspended brick dome in the idea of using brick, a very cheap material, to use, to somehow use the labor, that is, so that there is manpower enough in Albania, and so to somehow make something that uses the capacity of the country rather than import a steel structure from Germany as a gas station. It was a very interesting exercise, over-ambitious maybe, but it triggered a lot of interesting dialogue. This is the owner of that gas station. And this is Johan, my partner in the office, exchanging about design and inventing ways how to get it realized. And this small opportunity to build something as important as a gas station, you could say, was for us a very vital element of the whole design process, because we were able to test one-to-one some of the ideas that we projected on this building, which is all in all 38,000 square meters of square meters. And so we somehow could learn about the building industry and learn about the capacity on how to build in Tirana through this project, and also through this the very generous support of the thing that came out of it was not in the end a brick dome. It was a dome, but it was a steel dome, which was welded by a retired female welder that was educated during socialist time, who turned out to be one of the few persons that could do this job back then, and now 10 years ago, in Tirana, to weld something on that scale. Here you see how the dome is brought to place and lifted. And so in the end it was an assembly of steel, extremely roughly made, almost shocking how badly made it was. Also the polyester already after a few months started to crack. So it was really a very eye-opening experience. Also the way the construction cycles dealt with it, almost as a pagan ritual. Somehow revealed a lot of the extent of the gap that still exists. And to work on something is a very interesting situation, because these gaps are much more revealed than if you talk about something. Because if you talk about something, everyone indeed talks about what he would like, and not necessarily about what happens. We have been struggling and discussing a lot in the office whether now this is a successful project or not. For sure you can say that it's a project that has really absorbed the Albanian reality, and we have learned a lot from it. So this is how it turned out. This is eventually the gas station was sold to another owner, who applied the color scheme of his petrol company to it. And still today, the experience of filling up your car in this place is a noteworthy moment to remember. The impact on the tower, however, was that we drastically started to question what we were proposing. This was a proposal of the project in steel, done by the Belgian engineer that we collaborated with. A very sophisticated, very smart, very, let's say, material extensive proposal, you could say, but tested in the Albanian logic, so it really didn't make a lot of sense to make this exoskeleton. So the idea was to make the skin of the tower as the stiffening of the tower and not the core. Once we started to make this in the mock-up, it was clear that the resolution was way too high, it was way too difficult, and it would, you could tell that it was impossible, that to make such a thing would never happen, basically. And so then we convinced ourselves to really go back to the basics. Johan, for instance, went to a professor in Holland, which does research on margins, and how actually you can, that precision is not necessarily how good you build something, but precision is how you define margin, and how much error or tolerance that you allow. And so we started to really take a tolerance of centimeters rather than millimeters, which you have to do with steel, and to start to reason with an error margin which we felt was close to the possibilities that the building industry in the country was, the level that the building industry had. And so we somehow changed the skin of the tower, and looking for a resolution of panels of a brick skin that would work. And eventually we came to the proposal of seeing the tower not as a form, but basically as a series of floors. And that these floors, as you can see here, would have an edge which would be triangulated. And this triangulation, you could start to fold from the top to the bottom. And on this triangulation, which you see here, we then propose to mount a panel standing and to have a panel so that you somehow have this kind of pattern, but with a very big gap in between, the gap that allows to accept if you have one floor on top of the other and there's an error happening, that this error is absorbed by this void. So we somehow made a series of triangulations, stepping every time a bit up. So you have 24 floors, so 24 different floor steps. So a very basic system, and a system that, through its basic intelligence, allows to absorb these errors. And this proved to be a correct approach, because the I think it was the 13th or the 14th floor was cast twice, and actually in the results of the tower you don't see it, because this error margin is big enough to absorb it. Another thing that we worked a lot on during these years was how to take such a project, which is a huge project for Tirana standards. It was the biggest project in the capital when we delivered it. As you can see, also a lot of underground parking, and actually the tower is one part of the project, but there is also a base. And we worked very hard to make this base transparent to the city and not a kind of commercial internalized space, which turns it back to the city, which is, I think, a very big problem of towers in general, is that there's a lot of attention to how the top looks, but the way how the base looks with all of its logistics and all of these things coming together is often treated as a side note. Well, as a citizen, as an urban dweller, the footprint of a tower is anything but a side note, and it's very important exercise. We somehow were able to convince the developer that although the project looks like one big complex in section, that the way it should feel from the street would be just like a collection of buildings. So in the end, the building is made like three buildings, with the public space of the city just flowing through it, running in between the building. So although it's a very complex operation to really look for a certain simplicity, and also to look for how you can make a constellation of buildings, like a family of buildings, which make that the tower would absorb into the city. This building, we wanted to have a mineral to be seen from the central square. For this one, we tried a kind of variation on an international style building. And this is a collage of a Bundschaft building, an SOM building. I don't know if you know this architect, but this is one of the important international style, corporate style architects of the 20th century. And he has made a very beautiful concrete building in Brussels. Now it's the Marnix building, ING Marnix. And there they did a lot of innovation on how to use concrete as a noble material, and not just as structure, but also as finishing. And so we took the developer there to witness this building and to somehow change the connotation that he has with concrete. Because for him, concrete is the thing that you hide it between aluminium panels or behind aluminium panels. So this kind of learning process also for them of getting new experience and changing their set of references has been an important exercise. So it means that the tower in that sense has a very peculiar constellation. So this is not the project, but this is the project, and also this three-story building is part of the project. And to show the space in between the tower and the base, we had made a year ago, a very small movie, which I think sums up the atmosphere between the building in a very good way. So here you are in the space between the tower that you see on the left and the five-story building that you see on the right, and the space in between, which is an open air gallery. So this movie, you can obviously see that the tower has already competitors when it comes to the size. But I think you can also see how the building is like a continuous construction site. And this has been, I think, the biggest mental step that we had to take in order to make this project happen, is to somehow change the way you work as an architect and to be much more hands-on and much more one-to-one. And this goes, for instance, to develop this solution of the panels has been not only a process of doing the best proposal, but also to go for the best possible proposal. And I think this is a very crucial difference, because the best proposal, of course, might not look like this, but the best possible also means that you integrate the capacities of the people that have to build it and how they see it and how they imagine it feasible. And for that reason, we proposed to build a one-to-one mock-up outside of the city, which is a quarter piece of the tower, which has been assigned to basically test different variations, also test colors. And here on this picture, you see not only the architects and the engineers, but also the construction workers and the way how they imagine it feasible. And this kind of bringing it back, so this is a sample of, this is how the construction, this mock-up looks today. It's like, it's taken over by a small company that uses the bottom level, but not the first ones. But here you see how the image that we had, which somehow looks still quite sophisticated, was brought back to a level of detailing which was very recognizable and very manageable. So to somehow bridge this gap has been a very important exercise. And luckily, the eventual building is the quality is better than this one. So there's a kind of transfer of frame of reference. There's also, I think, a transfer of knowledge happening, and also an unearthing of knowledge. And that's why I will make a quick jump to a project that we won in 2008, which was a project for the Central Square, the city. I will not explain how the project looks like, but simply to say that the proposal that we made was to have a central void surrounded by an urban forest, and the central void was the idea to make it in stone, in mineral. And so we started to work on the underground of the project and started to investigate also out of what type of Albanian stone could we make this central square. And this was an extremely interesting investigation because we met old professors which were trained during socialist times and which had still their shelves full of maps, extremely well made, precise maps of the geological substructure of the country. And we really found a huge amount of extremely beautiful stones. Actually, Albania sits on the place where the tectonic plates of Europe meet the ones of Africa, and so you had a lot of movement in the past, which gives this kind of extremely rich variety of possible stones in very different locations in the country. And actually, this a lot of licenses being unused, being so in a way the resources are there, but the economy is not. And why do I show this? It's because we, in trying to find a way how to make, to produce the panels of the tower, we were looking and also discussing with Belgian companies to prefabricate them, also with Turkish companies. But eventually, together with the developer, we found the right constellation of local stones that we could use, and also setting up the right, like a local factory, to produce the stone, these panels on site. So these panels, you should imagine, are more or less the size of this table. And so now the building had this kind of first level of prefabrication, all the floors being cast on site, and all the panels being made in a local factory just around the corner, which also completely reduced the cost of the building and the kind of conglomerates that we could find were extremely rich and extremely beautiful. In the meanwhile, the Skanderbeg Square was underway and was halted, so there was a change so these were the renders that were made for the municipal elections, which was somehow by only a handful of votes was won by the other party, and so the project was drastically stopped, and the void that we had designed, that you saw in the image before, was 3 weeks later turned into a huge roundabout. Which gave us actually the time to continue our investigation in the state of the country, collecting ideas and further knowledge on how the territory is organized. In the meanwhile, the project further developed, and so the first idea of the building was to build a mixed-use tower, which eventually became an office tower, and finally has become a hotel, for which we did proposals on how to furnish it, but we really underestimated the necessity also to get all of these things on site in such a short amount of time. And so we somehow lost this commission of furnishing the tower to Italian studio, which was able to deliver all of the things, all of the apparatus that we need to make the rooms run. Why do I say this? I think I tried to make a point on how close also in the to work in a condition like this. The whole thing that we take for granted here in Belgium, the fact that this building industry exists and that you can rely on it, and that you basically as an architect become someone that manages these supply flows, you could say. In a way, in Belgium you don't invent a lot, you reassemble a lot. It was for us interesting to see that the situation of being an architect there is very close to being a contractor almost. And obviously we were not prepared to be that. We did propose also to, when you think about a hotel in such a small country, a five-star hotel, to change the layout of the plan and to start and make maybe a more hybrid model of what a hotel could be. And this is a kind of proposal to make a plan which also contains living and working spaces together. You should imagine that this is one of the few buildings in Tirana which is legally fireproof, fire secure. So here you have a double stair. So this, in a way, it's in the country one of the few buildings that a foreign company could go to and claim that it's a safe building for its workers to live and work in. I think this is a very interesting idea, was not taken up, might come in the future. With the hotel, of course, also comes the need for auxiliary spaces, like a conference center, a venue to host the events. And this again showed the mentality of how this building was looked at. So it's not something that was drawn up and then implemented, but really the process of building it and the process of seeing what it does, somehow seeing how people react to it, somehow informed the program and made it evolve. So the developer's proposal was to put the venue underground. So we started demolishing the Galleria, only to come to the conclusion that it really wouldn't work. He felt it, but you should imagine that above here the tower is completely built. So it's actually, when the building is being built, it's already an adaptive reuse project. We proposed to extend the three-story building and to turn it into a four-story building. With the venue as a freestanding pavilion in the hall, which is how it's turned out today. So with this being the plan, you have the plan of the tower, and then you have a freestanding pavilion with a kind of double facade, which gives this kind of dark environment, which makes you have a very intense view towards the city. And this is the state of, I think this is a bit the mentality of this project, and actually I find it very interesting. I think it's interesting that you can actually think of a building and the way it relates to the city. And at the same time, while you have this kind of overall relationship set and this kind of meaning given value, well, at the same time, inside this building, there are things on a micro scale being changed, being adapted. And I think it also says something about how you could think about architecture, how architecture could set a kind of large scale relation. A relation to the city, a relation to the panorama, a certain margin that the building has. For instance, the facade is going from floor to ceiling, so it's not a curtain facade, but it's in a way a very local facade. And that the rest of the program and the rest of the solutions are things that can evolve and things that can adapt. I think the capacity of the building to adapt and to think a building in different scales of time. I think it's a very interesting and intriguing way of looking at architecture as a tool to structure time in different time spans. Especially for a country like Albania, this makes a lot of sense because progress doesn't happen linearly. It happens in jumps. And I think this kind of jump is also something that you can start to organize. Why we show this picture is that this, for instance, is M-Pesa, is a tool for mobile banking, which was developed in Africa and which actually found root in Albania. And Albania is the only country in Europe that has this type of device. So it's it has been developed for informal settlements, for people to have insurances and to be without currency, because currency, like real money, is also something dangerous. And so this kind of, I think this image sums up very much what kind of strange links exist in the country. And I think it's interesting to look at the reality and to observe these links as they are, rather than how we think they should be. This picture is taken at the very same moment as this picture, and I think also indeed this says something about how you can look back and look forth, be somehow stuck in the past and be thrown into the future at the very same moment. as I said, and this is maybe not the most clear, but an important part of the tower has been to develop it as from this to this, where before it was a base with a thing that was rising from it. Today it has become three very clearly identifiable buildings which connect. And we have tried to make this kind of base of the tower as urban as possible. For instance, seeing the lights as an urban street light, and also treating this cupola has been an exercise in itself. So as you notice maybe in other pictures, this lowest building is made in concrete, and this concrete was actually the way how the construction workers started to make the dome, as they imagined it fit, and it turned out actually to be very beautiful, a kind of technique that in Belgium would be impossible to afford. And so once we had this dome and we saw how beautiful this concrete was, we somehow decided to also make the rest of the building in the same technique. So the shape of that building has actually been informed by how the construction site has taken shape. Here you can also see the application of gold leaf on that concrete, which somehow brings two very different aspects of the country together. So this is how the ground floor of the tower looks, and it's actually the shape of the tower which gives it an identity, and also this shape of the quarter of a circle around this monument, and the rest of the building is actually the infill of that. So you have these two different urban moments that are somehow structured, and the rest of the building is somehow, you could say, urban furniture, almost like a kiosk-like approach that structures the rest of the building. It means that if you look at this ellipse, that if you are on the outside of the building looking inside, or if you are in the inside of the building at night, that you have this kind of similar relation. And also I think one important thing is that if you listen to the dark interior of this three-story building, which is a five-star hotel, so a very high-end environment, but still through this galleria there are people passing that normally would be excluded from that type of complex. And I think that's also a quality that you can develop in such complex projects, is that you can really play with where the boundary of the project is and how transparent the building becomes. And transparent, I don't mean visually transparent, but transparent in the sense of socially inclusive. This is a view during the construction site of that quarter dome. This is a detail of that dome. and how this dome is actually indeed trying to value a quality that Albania very much has, and that's the kind of intense use of the public space and giving that even with a project of that scale, I think you can value these elements, and I think it's we are very convinced that it's very important to also value these small things. I wanted to give one last example, maybe a side note, a recent version of the Prime Minister's office. One last example of how architecture is somehow trying to frame public space, and how architecture also starts to reveal itself through the conditions that you find. The idea of this project is to make a building which has been closed for 100 years now. To open it up and to make it accessible. So this is how the building looked before. It was built by the Italians, was then taken over by socialism. And this is the state of the archives of the prime ministers, all the leaders, let's say, of the country. And so the idea of this project is to make a place at the heart of power, which is external to it, which makes these archives accessible. Which is, of course, an important institutional project and also a way how to deal with your past, to be able to look things up and to have some transparency in that. This is then mixed with the idea of making it into a hybrid cultural venue, so to make a series of spaces which are both political spaces but also cultural ones. And so it means that in this building, that the ground floor is carved out, which has this canopy which makes it open to the public space, and which contains an exhibition space, a library, a meeting room, auditorium, a small auditorium. And so it's a space that is accessible for the public, but is at points also used for ceremonial events to invite, to welcome other heads of state. So here you see during the opening how a work by Thomas de Mans serves as the backdrop of a ceremonial meeting. This space here is the protocol hall, and today it looks like this. So this marble floor was existing, and in a way also this ceiling was existing, but was hidden, and the ceiling was cracking, and when we opened it up, we found out that it had been cast in the beginning with not enough rebar, so there was some contractor that made some money on not putting enough steel in the concrete, because the difference on site was different than what we found on the plans. And we also found somehow reinforcements had been added in later stages, and we decided in that moment to add another layer of reinforcements to the building, which you see here, and then to paint the ceiling in slightly different colors of gray, so to somehow restore the space as it is, changing the position of an opening, but then somehow reveal this ceiling as a layered thing, which makes a very simple room, but which gets this tension through an element which has a very strong symbolic meaning. And which is a kind of playing with how building elements can also be narrative. I think this is in the end has become a very narrative space, a very accessible space, a space that doesn't need someone to be trained as an architect to understand it. And in Albania you find it in a very small moments, and I think everywhere you find it in very small moments. This is, for instance, a picture of the office space we have in Tirana, where you see tiles being applied backwards and painted over, and bricks being made in wood, which somehow gives a very, I think this type of improvisation and this type of invention, which is, I think, a very daily invention, I think this is the type of quality that we are very interested to add to architecture. So to see it almost as something that is made rather than designed. and then to maybe round up, I was saying in the very beginning that the project of the tower was one of the things that we are doing. As you can see, the center of the city is a very empty center. It's a socialist space. It has been erased for a large part. And the project of the Skanderbeg Square, by adding this urban forest around the void, we somehow want to propose to use this quality of this emptiness, but to make it attractive and to turn the center almost like an urban forest, as I was saying. In 2016, the project rebooted after the 5 years of political change. And the reason why I showed this simply is again to the project of the tower has taken 12 years to complete. This project took a long time to start, but in the past year we were able to implement it. And so a year ago we were still in this stage of looking at the changes since that went over the 5 years, setting up a series of conversations around how the project could develop, looking at how the square could be made. And this is the situation of just before the summer, where the center has indeed become completely car-free, and where a series of gardens around the central square has been laid out. And I find it very striking that a country like Albania, which has a very bad reputation, is able to make its city center into a model that even a lot of cities in Belgium are not able to produce. Which is, I think, a very big challenge, that you could say, to the rest of Europe. If I see how the Pied-à-Nier in Brussels is this kind of heap of misery, I think there's something that maybe we should accept that the balance sometimes shifts. What you see in the center of the square is we've made a pyramid, and these are points of water that flow down this pyramid. And the reason why we made this pyramid is that you can walk up to the center and be on the same level as the buildings. So now this space is a completely pedestrian space. And the tower is just one of the elements that you see from this central space. This is how the tower looks today in the summer. So the fence is gone, and the project is in full use. And the way how a project of this scale and this size makes a city and actually produces an environment that is very open, very inclusive. We are very happy that we arrived at a result like that. If you look at architects at some parts of the building, we are less happy. I mean, there are some things that we that happened that we think is maybe less successful. But this kind of value, this kind of opening up of a ground floor and making a building which shapes a city, is a quality that we think will be. That has a lot of value both for the project but also for the society that is in. And that's also the reason why we moved to the Quartier Nord, because we have the feeling that the same type of emptiness of the public space that you had before in Tirana, that you can feel it in the North District of Brussels, and the same kind of collision of scales, that the big scale actually does not contradict the small scale. And the reason why we installed ourselves in Brussels is to run a series of studios in a period of a year and a half, well, now that this World Trade Center is being empty, we do it also in collaboration with different schools. So it's a platform. It is open for people to come and use it. Already the School of Sint-Lucas in Brussels has joined. I'm running a studio with the University of Hasselt. La Cambre in Brussels is also joining. It is possible, we are thinking about, we are discussing, let's say, organizing together with architecture work in Brussels, that maybe the Biennale of Rotterdam would have its dependents. They are thinking about a double Biennale, that a part would be in the base of this World Trade Center. So keep your eyes open, maybe in the summer of 2018, it will be a place to visit. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.